Welcome to Worship with Messiah Online. As always, we pray that you're blessed as you worship with us. Just one brief announcement before we get into worship. Coming soon, and I can't promise you exactly how soon yet, but coming soon is a new online Bible study looking at the Old Testament as Jesus' Bible. And we'll look at what the Old Testament tells us about Jesus and how it helps us understand his ministry and what he does for us better. With that, we'll begin worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Conquered the grave, you free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things, God. You do great things. And break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things.
Hallelujah, God, above it all, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things. Sing that again. Hallelujah, God, above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. You have done great things. You do great things.
Let's pray. Shine into our hearts the light of your wisdom, your love, and your compassion, Lord, and open our minds to the knowledge of your word. By the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to think and act in accordance with your will, and to live in the light of your Son, in whose name we pray. Amen. And our scripture today is from Colossians chapter 3, beginning at the 12th verse. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. That's the word of the Lord.
January 6th was Epiphany Day in the church year, a day that light and love are celebrated. Last week, Pastor Jay spoke beautifully about the wise men or the magi. And there's a sad irony that on Wednesday of this week, actually Epiphany Day, a day of light and love, that we witness the darkness and bloodshed and death of the shocking protests that took place in our nation's capital. It's a powerful reminder that our nation is fractured. We saw rage and fear, pain and violence on the steps of our capital, which is supposed to be a monument and a testament to the beauty of our democracy. There is, as we all know, extreme tension on both sides of the aisle, and I don't need to go into all the reasons. We already know them. This behavior that we witness cannot be accepted or excused, and it is not the way God wants us to step into this new year or to live any day or moment of our life. I know for many of us, we couldn't take our eyes off our television or our computer screens. And terror and violence, corruption, fraud, political extremists, it's all predicted and talked about in God's word. And we know that as Christians that we're not immune from the troubles of this world. Jesus actually tells us, in this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Epiphany is what some would call the 12th day of Christmas. It's the day where the visit of the Magi is celebrated, the Magi who followed the star in the sky to find the baby Jesus. And they were guided by the light to discover and worship the light of the world. And this light of the world reminds us what love does. Love requires us to be kind, to be compassionate, to be understanding. St. Francis of Assisi put it this way in his prayer for peace: Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. We have a long way to go to live this way. And like the wise men, we too must not travel the way of violence or hatred or fear. We must go another route. It is the way of Epiphany. It is the way of light and love. It is the way of the light of the world. Folks, we're in this together. And we must let God love and direct our way. In Isaiah 9, verses 6 and 7, words we hear from the prophet Isaiah that are so familiar at Christmas time. Verse 6 says, "For us, to us a child is born, to us a son is given." And we know this is the gift and the promise and the hope of Christmas. But today, it's verse 7 that seems so significant. "And the government will be upon his shoulders, and the greatness of his government, and peace there will be no end." The government will be on his shoulders, and his great government and peace will never end. Ultimately, folks, this is the good news for today. And every day it reminds us that God is in control. And as followers of Jesus, this is not and never will be about finding our ultimate satisfaction or redemption in earthly powers, because our primary citizenship and our deepest loyalty and our first love is not to this country, but to the kingdom of God. Martin Luther King Jr., in a sermon on Romans 12:2, talked about how we're able to be transformed and not conformed to this world. He says that the Church of Jesus Christ is to regain once more its power, message, and authentic reign. It must conform only to the demands of the gospel. And so we must remind ourselves what those demands of the gospel are and what our purpose is. Let me read the words that we've already heard from Colossians today. And they remind us of both the demands of the gospel and our purpose. Put on then, clothe yourselves as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassion, kindness, lowliness, meekness, and patience, forbearing one another. And if one another has a complaint against one another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. I love putting on new clothes. They have a way of making me feel so good. In fact, today I'm wearing a new shirt that I got for Christmas. And after I got dressed and all ready for the filming today, I looked in the mirror at home and I thought to myself, whoa, I look good. In the same manner, Paul tells us, clothe ourselves each day. Be prepared to go out into the world, not only to look good, but to do good, to be the goodness, the compassion, the humility, the grace, and the forgiveness of Jesus that people desperately need. You know, sometimes loving is pretty easy. Sometimes it's pretty easy to do it. Other times, loving like Christ is a sacrifice. It's challenging. And ultimately, loving like Christ is a choice that we make. In these complex and these confusing times, one of the most important articles of love that we can clothe ourselves with is forgiveness. We're told over and over in the Bible, we pray it in the Lord's Prayer, to forgive others as Christ has forgiven us. There is a growing need for forgiveness. As an example of this need, over the past 4 or 5 years, I've witnessed families and friendships torn apart from political and partisan divides. I spoke recently with a father who's not seen or talked with his adult son for the past 4 years because of their different entrenched political views. This is not the life that God wants for any of us. This is not the witness that Jesus asks us to live out. Over the years, I've had many people tell me that forgiveness sounds great, but it's just unrealistic. And sometimes I have to admit that forgiveness, if left up to our own power, it is unrealistic. It is unattainable. Sometimes we're just afraid of giving it up because we think the offender, the person who has hurt us, they haven't paid a high enough price yet. And we think of forgiveness as transactional. We make it conditional. But the deep forgiveness of the soul, the deep forgiveness of Christ, is actually not transactional on our part. It's actually about what we know as unconditional love. And some will reply to me, yeah, but you don't know how this person hurt me. You don't know what they did to me. Forgiveness, honestly, is one of the most difficult paths any of us can take. And it's so easy to stay angry at the people who have hurt us deeply. And the truth is, many times the person who has hurt us probably rightfully deserves our anger and much more. But the choice to forgive and release those who have hurt us is one of the greatest gifts that you and I can give. And notice that I said gift. Forgiveness is not forgetting what has happened to us or minimizing its effect on our life. Forgiveness is not the same as reconciliation even or restoring a broken relationship. You may forgive a person, but the reality is the relationship may not be healed. Forgiveness is not condoning or excusing behavior. It's not forgetting. It's not justifying. It's not just calming down. Forgiveness is not just words. In the Bible, the word forgiveness often means sending away or letting go. And those are phrases that conjure up the image of a caged animal releasing them back into the wild. Or imagine releasing a dove to freedom. It flies away from your hands high into the sky. Holding on to the anger we feel about our past, not forgiving, is like living with a wild squirrel in our house. It slowly destroys our house from the inside out. But maybe the squirrel has been living there for so long that we're not even sure what life would be like without it. Forgiveness is not forgetting what happened to us. Instead, it's simply letting the wild squirrel living in our house go free, releasing it from our house. Forgiveness is the choice. It's making the choice to stop carrying the weight of our past. It's giving up our right to get even with those who've hurt us. Forgiveness is making the choice to move forward, not allowing our past to hold us hostage any longer. Forgiveness is not a feeling. And we don't wait until we feel like forgiving. Forgiveness is a choice we make to move forward. It's a choice to actually love as Christ loved, with a forgiving heart. Christ didn't wait to forgive us until we had done something to earn it. No, it was given unconditionally. And so we too can make that choice to forgive. And it is then that the feelings will eventually flow. And I know that forgiveness is a struggle for all of us at one time or another. When I was in high school in about 1974, I had the honor of meeting a woman by the name of Corrie Ten Boom at a conference. And Corrie has just a powerful testimony of faith. And she shared this personal, powerful, impactful account of the challenge of forgiveness. It's a story that she also writes about in her book, The Hiding Place, written after she had been released from a Nazi concentration camp. And in fact, the last few years of Corrie's life, she lived right here in Placentia. Corrie writes, "It was in a church in Munich where I was speaking in 1947 that I saw him, a balding, heavy-set man in a gray overcoat, a brown felt hat clutched between his hands. One moment I saw the overcoat and the brown hat, the next a blue uniform and a visored cap with its skull and crossbones. Memories of the concentration camp came back with a rush. The huge room with its harsh overhead lights, the pathetic pile of dresses and shoes in the center of the floor, the shame of walking naked past this man. And I could see my sister's frail form ahead of me, ribs sharp beneath the parchment of skin. Betsy and I had been arrested for concealing Jews in our home during the Nazi occupation of Holland," she writes. "This man had been a guard at Ravensbrück, a concentration camp where we'd been sent. Now he was out in front of me, hand thrust out. 'A fine message, Fraulein. How good it is to know that, as you say, all our sins are at the bottom of the sea.' It was the first time since my release that I'd been face to face with one of my captors, and my blood seemed to freeze. 'You mentioned Ravensbrück in your talk,' he was saying. 'I was a guard there. But since that time,' he went on, 'I've become a Christian. And I know that God has forgiven me for the cruel things I did there. But I would like to hear it from your lips as well, Fraulein.' And again the hand came out. 'Will you forgive me?' Corrie says, 'I stood there, and I could not. Betsy had died in that place. Could he erase her slow, terrible death simply for the asking? It could have been many seconds that he stood there, hand held out, but to me it seemed like hours as I wrestled with the most difficult thing I'd ever had to do. For I had to do it. I knew that. The message that God forgives has a prior condition, that we forgive those who've injured us. If you do not forgive men their trespasses, Jesus says, neither will your Father in heaven forgive yours. And still I stood there with the coldness clutching my heart. But forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. Jesus, help me, I prayed silently. I can lift my hand. I can do that much. You supply the feeling, Jesus. And so woodenly, mechanically, I thrust my hand into the one that was outstretched to me. And as I did, an incredible thing took place. The current started in my shoulder and raced down my arm, sprang into our joined hands. And then his healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being, bringing tears to my eyes. 'I forgive you, brother,' I cried, 'with all my heart.' For a long moment, we grasped each other's hands, the former guard and former prisoner. I had never known God's love so intensely as I did right then. There is that same need of forgiveness around us today. That same need in many of our families and some of our closest relationships. There's a need for that forgiveness in our churches, in our nation, and in our world. And so let me bring this story close and right home to you and ask you today, who do you need to forgive? Because love, the love of God, love actually forgives. And let me warn you, though, the forgiving and loving, as we just heard from Corrie Ten Boom, it is actually not always easy, and it can sometimes actually mean that those around us will not want the love and the light that we want to share with them. But it is a love that is the core of everybody's ultimate desire and needs. As I attempt to share this message of hope and love with people in these challenging times, I have come across some people who clearly don't want to hear it. I've been called names, been told I wasn't American, I've been called a snowflake, that I'm a communist and not a Christian. I've been told by some that I should avoid addressing the issues in our world around us because it might make someone uncomfortable. And that I should make sure, above everything else, that my message is always neutral. My friends, the gospel message of Jesus Christ, the gospel message of love and justice, of compassion and forgiveness, is many things, but the one thing it is not, it is never neutral. And to apply the gospel to our lives and to the world around us is so important, because it is not an intellectual theory. To apply it means that we understand that Jesus is the living Word. And it is critically important, day after day, week after week, to remind ourselves ultimately who is in control, and that you and I, that we are children of the light and not the darkness. And the gospel message of Jesus that I try to share is not just about what happened in Washington, D.C. this week. It's about who you are and who I am. It's about who God is, and it's about the demands of the gospel and our willingness to boldly shine the love of Jesus into the fractures of our lives, of our nation, and our world. It's about how, in the face of things that we don't understand, in the face of things that are dark sometimes and violent and evil, in the face of those things, that every day we get up and we clothe ourselves in Christ's goodness and love, always willing to stand in the gap and to do what love demands. It is not about forgetting. It is not about forgetting what has hurt us. It is about not forgetting, as I so often like to say, who we are and whose we are. And that the two greatest commands given by Jesus are the very demands of the gospel itself, that we are to love God and to love one another. That is love, actually. Please pray with me. Dear God, You've created each of us in Your image, and You've shown Your deep, abiding love for us. We ask You to look with Your deep compassion on us. Strip us of our arrogance and our hatred, which so easily can infect our hearts and our minds. Tear down any walls that separate us. Give us courage and wisdom to understand and accomplish Your purpose for our lives. we realize that our purpose will always have something to do with unity and love and serving other people. And we come before you in this time of difficulty, confused and struggling to find meaning in the face of suffering and violence, where tempers have been flaring and partisan spirits have provoked hostility. Raise up people who have patience and restraint, kindness and compassion, courage and wisdom. And we pray for those who are engaged in making important decisions in this time and for those who shape public opinion. Direct our government in the way of peace and justice and deliver us from the sins which lead us to conflict and violence. And strengthen within each of us the will to do justice, the will to love mercy, and the will to walk humbly with you and with each other. Open us up to do what the gospel demands, and open us to receive and to share your forgiveness. We desperately seek your light to be made ever more visible to us and through us. Please, God, do not let us settle for being less than who we really are. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer, and all God's people say, amen.
Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love.
Jim Hodgson, one of your volunteer co-captains for Messiah's Relay for Life team, Team Messiah YL. Relay for Life is a grassroots community-based event sponsored by the American Cancer Society. The event celebrates people who have battled cancer, remembers loved ones who we've lost, and takes action year-round to raise funds for cancer research and support programs. I hope you'll join us in this fight to defeat cancer.
This year's Relay for Life is scheduled for May 1 at El Rancho Charter School in Anaheim Hills. If you would like more information about joining the team, you can contact Jim Hodgson. Please join Messiah YL in the fight against cancer. Now, at this point in the service, we give you the opportunity to make financial gifts to Messiah's ministry. This allows us to continue changing lives for Jesus as we learn more and more to love God and love one another. We are incredibly grateful to those of you who give so regularly. Many of you are diligent in bringing a check or making an online offering on a regular basis. But sometimes your life gets crazy, doesn't it? Maybe your kids get sick, you're out of town over the weekend, things come up that you couldn't have anticipated. Life happens. That's why we make it possible for you to give online through our app or our website. Or, of course, you can do that through your bank's online giving and set it to give on a recurring basis. That way you can be sure to support our ministries of loving God and loving one another, even when life gets in the way. We also want to remind you that if you haven't pledged a weekly, monthly, or annual gift to Messiah yet, you can still do that on our website. As always, you can give today online or with a check. Or you can bring a check on Monday and leave it with our food drop-off. Again, thank you for all you do to support Messiah's ministries and for the kingdom. Let's pray. Eternal God, amid all the turmoil of this world, your love is steadfast and your strength never fails us. In this time of trouble, be to us a guardian and a rock of defense. When our hearts are fearful, grant courage and hope. When anxiety is infectious and widening, grant peace and assurance. When distrust twists our thinking, grant healing and illumination. Where our spirits are daunted and weakened, grant us strength and the courage to dream of a better world in which your values reign in our lives. Guide the leaders of our nation with your wisdom. Comfort those in distress. And grant us courage and hope to face the future. We pray this in the mighty name of your Son, Jesus, the true light of the world whom the darkness cannot overcome. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom. Teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never failed me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life, you have been. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. The goodness of God, I will sing of the goodness of God.
And once again, thank you so much for joining us today online for worship here at Messiah. And now receive the benediction. And now may God go before you to show you the way, above you to watch over you, beneath you to support you, beside you to be your best friend, and within you to fill you with peace, love, and uncontainable joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.